Good evening. Excuse me again. Good evening, brothers and sisters. Welcome to the Prayer Retreat Ministry, the program that edifies the truth as it is written in the Bible and the spirit of prophecy. Welcome. And thank you once again for coming to join us. So let us begin with a word of prayer. Our Father in heaven, we come to you this evening, thankful that we have made it through another day. As we seek for the gift of salvation, dear Lord, we must remember the promise of our Father, the gift of eternal life. We are not perfect. We have shortcomings, blemishes. But God, in his compassionate love, said we must be perfect, even as our Father in heaven, which is perfect. Thank you, Lord, for sending your son, Brother Don, to remind us of the plan for us, of your plan for us. Give him wisdom, knowledge, and understanding, dear Lord, to teach us as we listen to your words of truth. Pour out your spirit in this place. This is my humble prayer in your name. Amen.
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 Amen. Welcome again, once again, to all who has joined on this platform. Now we'll have the Tutley sisters who will give us a song. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome. The song I'm going to share is called Look Away. So.
Must tell them there is hope.
Amen. Amen. Beautiful song. Beautiful song. And sung so beautifully as well. Thank you. Good evening, Brother Don. And thank you for joining us today, and sharing your presentation on the gift of salvation. Now, we don't want to take up any more of your time. So the time is now yours. Welcome.
Good evening, everyone. I hope you've had a wonderful day. It's been a fantastic sunny day. And I was, as I normally do, rushing to get home. I don't not normally home at this time, but God has allowed me the ability to make this special time because I promised my friends, the Duckley twins, that I will present this week. And it has been a very interesting preparation. So before we go further, let's have a word of prayer. Father in heaven, I bow asking you to cleanse my heart and my mind, my lips and my tongue. Every follicle of my hair, every ounce of my being, every cellular level of my cells that compose who I am, may it reflect you. May you guide us, Lord. May we speak, sing, talk, walk, think, dream, meditate upon who you are. So as we read and listen to your words today, Father, may you change us inside out so that we can be called good and faithful servants is my plea. In Jesus' name, amen.
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 This evening, I'm
Yes.
going to want to share again the screen. Hopefully it will give me what I'm after. Okay, share. Can you see the screen? If you
Yes,
can.
I am. Yes, thank you.
This is called part two, Understanding the Gift. And I'm still dwelling on the subject, this same Jesus. And it has been a thought process of mine over the last 6 to 8 weeks. I never thought I'd be presenting on it, but I thought I'd share what my thoughts and my meditations are. So please don't take it as a presentation as such. It's more of a sharing what my thoughts have been when as I read the Word of God. One little recap for those who weren't here to begin with. Yesterday, we looked at the war in heaven in Revelation 12, where Michael and his angels fought against the dragon and his angels. And the archangel Michael cast out that little serpent called the devil onto the earth. We also want to look at the inhabitants of the earth was warned that the dragon would come down and he had a great wrath because he knew he had but a short time. It tells us that the inhabitants, those of us who surrender to God, will overcome the dragon by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of our testimony. We talked about the dragon's people being followed by the woman. Sorry, the dragon's people follows the woman, sorry, and makes war with those who keep the commandments of God and have to pay for Jesus Christ. We recognize also that the plan of salvation was foreordained, preordained before the foundation of this world. And the sacrifice of the Lamb of God, Jesus Christ, our risen Savior, was already put in place before. I've got to go as far as to say this, brethren. Letting the cat out of the bag, even before the heavenly throne room was made. Because the Bible tells us, plan of salvation was there before the foundations of the world. We talked about being chosen, and salvation is a free gift to everyone who surrenders their heart to God. Yet, with all of these promises, we recognize the enemy was cast down and he enters the earth where our first parents encounters him. So we know the story in Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And God said, let there be light, and there was light. We recognize the second day the firmament was made, the third day dry land and sea appeared, the fourth day it was grass and trees. The third day, sorry. And the fourth day there was the firmament and the sun. The fifth day was the sea and the sea animals and the flying creatures. And the sixth day was the land animals and the creeping things. And Adam and Eve were created. But we recognize one thing God did when he made and formed Adam and Eve off the ground. He gave them a warning not to go near the tree of knowledge and good and evil. He told them not to touch it, not to eat from it, not to eat the fruit. Because in the day that they eat, they will shall surely die. I'm bringing this to us because I believe this same temptation is our daily challenge. It's our daily challenge. And most of the times I have conversations with fellow Christians and they said, I would have never eaten of the fruit. Is that true? Let's walk through the temptation for a bit. So the Bible tells us, let's go to Genesis chapter 3 and 2 and 3, sorry. The Bible tells us clearly that the Lord made the tree and the trees were in the midst of the garden. I'm looking at Genesis chapter 2, for those of us who want to follow along in the Bibles. And I like how it puts it. It tells us in verse 16, and the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest eat freely, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it, for in the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die. And you think about this very carefully, because it tells us in Genesis 3:3, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God hath said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. And one thing we realized, there were two trees in the midst of the garden. There was the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, and there was the tree of life. And I always ask myself the question, it was only one tree. Based on archaeological finds of the magnificent fossilizations, it is recorded that the amount of foliage and trees on the planet Earth at the time of Adam and Eve far outnumbered what we have today. The variety of fruits and plants were multitudinous. Maybe I'm making up a new word, but it was so abundant that I don't understand why the one tree God said you should not eat of it, they decided to eat from it. And I want us to think very carefully of this temptation, because the temptation is a very similar temptation that we have on a daily basis, as I keep saying. You see, John, 1 John chapter 2 gives us an indication of how temptation works. Matthew chapter 4 is a replica of 1 John 2, 16. Let's go to 1 John 2, 15, 16. And I want us to look at what temptation does and how it forms. So 1 John 2, I want to make sure I'm giving you the right text. 1 John 2, yes, 15, 16, and 17. If someone has found that text, it'd be nice if someone could read. 1 John 2, 15, 16, and 17.
I'll read.
By all means, my sister.
Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world passeth away, and the lust thereof. But he that doeth the will of God abideth forever.
Thank you, my sister. Very well read. Now, when I read that text, I was convicted that the temptations that Adam and Eve had wasn't quite of the same type, but it had the same facets to it, if you understand where I'm coming from. Adam and Eve were made perfect. They had not a sinful bone in their body, not a sinful cell. Yet the tempter was able to seduce and deceive Eve. And in turn, she also seduced her husband. And in so doing, she carried out the task of the enemy to get the first parents of the earth to give in and give their dominion to him. I recognize that Adam went in knowing full well that he was going to have to die with the woman he loved. I recognize that he knew that biting of the fruit, taking of the fruit was a sin. But I wanted to think of it very carefully. What is temptation? What does it do to us? How are we tempted? What is lust? I believe that without a doubt, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life will be the three temptations. I will keep repeating this during the week that will keep us from achieving the one goal if we allow ourselves to fall into temptation and not to flee from it. The reason I'm saying this is because when you see Jesus's temptation, and I'm probably mixing up my presentation because I've got a few slides and my mind is racing. When we see Jesus's temptation, it was the same type. The enemy said unto him, "If thou be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread." It had to do with food, with eating. Yes, he was hungered for 40 days and 40 nights. But why was it stone? And why was it bread? You see, brethren, we have to understand this wonderful thing called temptation. In the Bible, bread is symbolic of what? The Word of God, the manna from heaven, the body of Christ. And stones is symbolizes what? Judgment. When someone was being judged in the Old Testament, they were stoned to death. And in Daniel chapter 2, we are told that the great image that was made of head of gold, arms and chest of silver, belly and thighs of brass, legs of iron, feet of iron and miry clay. In Daniel chapter 2, they said a great stone that was cut out without hands landed on the feet of this image and it was destroyed and the kingdom of God came out of it. Now get this, brethren. Peter was called a rolling stone, a pebble, but nowadays he's believed to be the stone of the church, the first priest of the Christian era. We know that's not true. But we know that Jesus Christ is the stone. So contemplate this for one moment. The enemy of souls is tempting the Savior to take a stone representing judgment to make bread, something that is given a symbolic of him. Isn't that interesting? And our first parents had the same type of temptation, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. How do I know this? Because when the enemy spoke to Eve, he said, "You should be as gods, knowing good from evil." And what he was saying is that God doesn't want you to appreciate the expansive knowledge he's given to himself. And he's holding back something from you. If you just taste this fruit, you also can become like God. Look at me, I'm a serpent. I can fly and I'm speaking. How many serpents do you see speaking and flying? That was the allurement, that was the deception. So, the tree in the midst of the garden, which one will you choose? The tree of life or the tree of knowledge of good and evil? I want you to think very careful, very carefully, because let's go to 1 Corinthians 10. I don't usually like to speak without giving text, so but I apologize. I'm getting overexcited. How do I know that this stone, this rock that he asked him to make into bread was that symbolic? What is Jesus called? What is Jesus called in the scriptures? David called him the rock of my salvation. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, in verse 4, and they'd all drink. I'll read it from the beginning. Let me start from verse 1. 1 Corinthians 10, verse 1. Moreover, brethren, I would not that ye should be ignorant how that all our fathers were under the cloud and all passed through the sea and were all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea, and did eat of the same spiritual meat, and did drink of the same spiritual rock, for they drank of the spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ. Can you see how deceptive and sneaky the enemy was? Use something that symbolizes you to make bread for you, who is really the true bread that came down from heaven. And how do we know this? Because Jesus says it in John chapter 6. That true bread that came down from heaven wasn't the manna that it wasn't Moses that gave you that meat. My Father in heaven. And I read these things, I'm like, wow. The deceiver is using common things around us to deceive us. How does he put it in about Jesus being the bread? The Bible said, put it this way, God put it this way. John 6:35. No, let's go back to 32, actually. No, let's go back further. It says this, verse 31. Our fathers did eat manna in the desert, as it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat. Verse 32 says, then Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, Moses gave you not that bread from heaven, but my Father giveth you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he that cometh down from heaven and giveth life unto the world. Now, brother, don't miss this bit. Satan wanted Jesus to take a rock and make it into bread. We know this bread represents doctrine. It represents the body and the body of Christ. And if you go to the sanctuary service, my brothers and sisters, you will see a note that the table of showbread is located on the north side of the sanctuary. Brethren, did you get that? The table of showbread is located on the north side of the sanctuary. What was on the table of showbread? Showbread. How many loaves were there? Two piles of six. And it had something on it. It was covered with incense, but also blue, the commandments, the table of showbread. And it was in the north side. Now, brethren, who wanted to ascend into the sides of the north so that he can be like the most high?
Satan.
Now you listen to this very carefully. When he commanded Jesus to take this stone and make it into bread, he wanted to use his bread because he wanted to be in the sides of the north to give Jesus the bread, the manna that he will teach him how he should be. That's what he's doing to us today, because in the sanctuary, the table of showbread is on the north side, and bread represents doctrine. It represents the manna from heaven that God gave to the people to sustain them for 40 years in the wilderness. Now, when we think about this, and I'm probably going too far because I'm meant to go slowly, I think we need to understand this, because if we get this, let's discuss, go to that text. Because by so doing, he, in this one question, he was doing two things. He wanted Jesus to obey his command, number one. And number two, he wanted Jesus to eat of his bread. Did you get that, brethren? Not you, are you with me, brethren? Everyone's very quiet.
Yes, we can hear you.
Amen.
I want us to think very carefully. As we recognize the temptation that happened in the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve did not have any examples of anyone in the past committing sin. They knew not of this. But by the mere fact that he took the fruit from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil and gave it to Eve, what happened? The fruit from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil supplanted the tree of life, the fruit from the tree of life. And therefore, by taking that tree fruit, the fruit from that tree, they gave not just Satan, just only his dominion over them, but they took of the seed of Satan. They took of his mindset, his character, his rebellion. By eating that fruit, they said, we choose rather his doctrine, his food, rather than God's food. Anyway, let me move on very quickly because I recognize the time. It's something very important because they did something that we do sometimes without realizing it. We are obeying the word. We are obeying the word. We're meant to be obeying the word, right? But whose word are we obeying? Whose fruit are we tasting? Are we tasting the manna from heaven? Or are we taking the rock and making it into the stones and making it into bread? Are we eating from the tree of life? Or are we eating from the fruit of the knowledge of good and evil? I want us to think, because by who we obey leads us to either fall into temptation or resist temptation. I'm going to move on because of time. So, I mean, of the four, they doubted the promise. Are we doubting the promises today? Are we being told? I mean, we had a very interesting configuration from 2020 all the way up to 2022 with the CV19 situation. And we were told by the Lord, I will sustain you, I will keep you, I will, you know, your bread and water is sure. We know that the issues of Elijah about the bread and the food that he ate, and he was sitting for 40 days. You know, Moses in the presence of God was sitting for 40 days. But this thing, we doubted the promise of God to keep us from evil. And we know the Lord's Prayer. We know it, we recite it. Most of us know it, but we lost sight. I'm not saying everyone. Even I, for a time, when I heard of the CV19 and China and the issues, I started doubting how far I could survive without a job. But I remember the Lord's Prayer, Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. What was his will be done? On earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread again. And we recognize that we need to go to him for our daily bread. Were we going having our daily bread? Or was our minds focusing on the cares of this world? We're doubting the promises, and that's what the fall did. It placed our minds that was in a higher state of existence. In other words, before the fall, Adam and Eve had the mind where the higher powers were more engaged in thinking. And the carnal nature, which is what we call it now, like appetite and passion and hunger and thirst, these are not evil within themselves. But if we allow the intellect and the reason and the creativity of the mind to be dwarfed and overcome by the passions of the lower mind, we become like brute beasts. We are not in control of ourselves. And that's what the fall did. So we start doubting God. We started doubting his promises. What else did he, and we and sometimes, like Adam and Eve, they were hiding from the consequences of eating that fruit because they said they were naked. Revelation 3 tells us this. The Laodicean age, the church of the Laodicean church, says, know you not that you are blind and what? Naked. They knew they were naked. And in the last days, we will find ourselves naked if we're not careful. I'm going to read that text. I don't want to shorten it. I know I'm maybe taking longer than I wanted to get to the points, but I'm finding this fascinating because I might have to jumble around my sermon a bit, my talk, because I know the bits I'm sharing with you now, it might be shared in a day or two. But listen, The Holy Spirit is God in my thoughts. In Revelation 3, it says this. I know thy works, verse 15, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would that thou were cold or hot. So then, because you are not, because you are so what? Lukewarm, and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth, vomit thee out of my mouth. Because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing, and knowest not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. This is what happened in the garden. Isn't that interesting, brethren? And we're having it today in our age. We are hiding from the consequences of our sins. And we like to do something else. We like to blame someone else. I always say the devil made me do it. It was my friend. It wasn't me. I didn't really meant to do it. It wasn't my fault. I didn't know any better. There are lots of accusations we make against others as well as God. Well, if God knew, I have heard this argument quite recently. Well, God knew that we were born in sinful condition. Why did he put me on this planet? Why can I be born in one of the unfallen worlds? We didn't do as Adam did, did we? Adam said, there's the woman that God gave us me. She gave me the fruit and I did eat. And that's what we do. It wasn't me, it was my friend. It was the person that you allowed in the church. It was the pastor that said it. The elder that said it. My husband or wife that did it. We blame God. And we are very, very close. Sorry. We're very, very close to fulfilling what I call the first lie continually in our experience. But you touch on that another time during the week. Jumping ahead of myself. So the promise of the seed of the woman was made right after they sinned. And this promise is for us. This same Jesus is part of my thoughts. This same Jesus was the seed of this woman. The woman we spoke about yesterday, the woman that fled into the wilderness, the woman that brought forth that man-child that would rule all nations with a rod of iron. This same Jesus is this seed of the woman that will bruise the head of the serpent. And I'll read it this way. I will put enmity between thee, referring to the serpent, and the woman, and between thy seed, the seed of the serpent, and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, referring to the serpent, and thou, meaning the serpent, shall bruise his heel. And that was fulfilled. They put this massive nail through Jesus' heel when he was on the cross. I had went to Rome and I saw the nails were like this size, huge things. And I was surprised at what they did in the crucifixion. I was in Rome and I saw talking about crucifixion and they showed you the crosses and the, I mean, I couldn't believe these things were so big and so heavy. And I said to myself, Lord have mercy, my Savior paid that price for me. He paid that price for you. But the one promise I can see here is that if there was not for the enmity between Satan and God, if there wasn't for the enmity between Satan's offspring and God's offspring, we would be in serious trouble. Now, when the conflict began, I'm going back to Revelation chapter 12. This wonder in heaven was the red dragon, having seven heads and 10 horns and 7 crowns upon his head. Now, this is very interesting because John is looking at the conflict at the beginning, but he's also seeing the conflict as it appeared in the prophetic aspect that we look back now, because we know in Revelation chapter 7, it tells us about the 10 nations, the 10 horns that came out of the beast. But what is happening here, John is looking back and he can see this great red dragon having 7 heads and 10 horns. I'll go into more detail of who these 10 horns are and the 7 heads are and with crowns upon his head. And it says this, and his tail drew a third part of the stars of heaven and did cast them to the ground, to the earth, sorry. And the dragon stood before the woman, which was ready to be delivered, or to devour her child as soon as it was born. When I first read this, I had all kinds of strange thoughts in my head. She brought forth a man child. We knew this is Jesus. We spoke about earlier on. And I thought to myself, this promised child, who we know is Jesus, our Lord and Savior, has given us so much. He has emptied himself of everything. And I thought about this for a very long time. I was wondering how in the world. And I said to myself, I'm not sure whether I could have done it. But he did it for us. He did this marvelous, wonderful thing for us. And I want us to think very carefully about this. Imagine this is an unimaginably powerful being that as he speaks, things are formed from the air follicles, from the air molecules that leaves his mouth. When he said, let there be light, that was Christ saying, let there be light, and there was light. His words have power. And that's why the word gospel is so powerful, because the word gospel is an old English word, is a combination of God's and the word spell, as in to cast a spell. We know that that isn't what God is doing, but that's the making up of the word God, gospel. And so it means God's words with power, God's word that creates, God's word that does not fall or fail, because whatever God says, he will do. He never fails. I mean, I want to read a couple of texts on that one. One of my favorite is John chapter 14. And I had a conversation with another person who says they don't believe this text, but we'll read it. John chapter 14. We like reading verse 15, but I want us to go back. John chapter 14 and look at the verses that precedes this particular section. John chapter 14, and it says this. Verse 10 to 13, well, verse 10 to 14, it says this. Believest thou not that I am in the Father, and the Father in me? The words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself, but the Father that dwelleth in me, he doeth the works. Some brethren don't want to get this. As he is on earth, he's left his divine power and glory behind. But he is one with the Father. The power of the Godhead dwelleth in Jesus. So when he was walking on this planet, he was clothed. He was clothed in human form, but the divinity was in him. The Heavenly Father, the omniscient Ancient of Days, and the Holy Spirit was in him because he was in the Father. And it says this in verse 11, believe me that I am in the Father and the Father in me, or else believe me for the very work's sake. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do shall he do also. Listen very carefully, brethren, and greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. And these two verses next, that is the one that says the grass. And whatsoever ye shall do in my name, whatsoever ye shall, ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. So listen to this very carefully. When we do something in the name of Jesus, in the character, because the word name means character, in Greek means character. When we do anything in the character of Christ, representing him, reflecting him to the world, he says, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. And the Son then shines through us. For we become the light of the world, because Christ is the light of the world, John 8:12. And it also says this, if ye shall ask, remember this, if ye shall ask anything in my name, I will do it. My brethren, I'm bringing this back to this because we're coming to the place where this conflict that began in the earth is coming to a head very soon. We need to develop that Christ-like mind so that when this time comes, the conflict of the ages, when the dragon shows up pretending to be Jesus Christ, when he becomes a Mahdi or the Messiah for the Jews, he will come as Mahdi for the Muslims. He'll become as the Maitreya for the New Ages. We can say no. We will not go because we know this is a false Christ. We know this. So who is the seed of the woman? We know the seed of the woman is Jesus Christ because in John, sorry, Matthew, it tells us. Now the birth of Jesus was on this wise when, as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Ghost. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man and not willing to make a public example, was minded to put her away privily. But when he thought on these things, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a dream, saying, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take thee Mary thy wife, for that which is conceived of her is of the Holy Ghost. Now, brethren, I'm going to read the last text. And she brought forth a son, and thou shalt, sorry, we read again slowly. And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Matthew chapter 1. Now, this text I'm bringing because this is the biggest conflict on this planet at the moment. The angel is speaking to whom? Joseph. And the angel tells Joseph that the name of the child shall be called Jesus, which means Savior. And he's saving these people from their sins. The issue we have today is that we want to be saved in our sins. We want to continue doing the things that we do, knowing it to be wrong, but believing that God is not that hard, really. And that's what the conflict is. Lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, pride of life. We still have that special feeling, almost like the Jewish nation. Who says we are Abraham's seed? You know, we're heirs to the promise. We're Seventh-day Adventists. God's not going to destroy us. We've got the truth. But this is a mistake, because we have got to get to the stage where we recognize that we are to be saved from our sins. We've got to get to the stage where we look back and recognize the sins of our forefathers, the great sin in the garden, and ask God to give us the strength to become more like his son, Jesus Christ, to have the mind where we know that the example of the enmity between the seed of the serpent and the seed of the woman becomes one, because the seed of the woman is Christ. Hence why we are called Christians, Christ-like. The character of Christ must be renewed in us on a daily basis. And I struggle today because my work colleagues were tempting me with all kind of strange things. And I was driving home saying, Lord, have mercy, my mind has been battered and bombarded by the enemy today. How can I give a message of life and hope? But Father is really, 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 really special. And I thank him for putting these words in my mouth. Now, I want us to think very carefully. Being saved from sin, what does that mean to us? The seed of the woman will empower us by the Holy Ghost so we can be saved from our sin. Do we go back to the, do we go back to this, to the sin? I believe not. Now, the seed is really important because we know that Jesus Christ was raised up. We know that he's the son of David, as in Romans chapter 1, verse 3. We know that this seed, and I'll read it from here, in verse Acts 13, verse 22, and when he had removed him, he raised up unto them David, removed who? King Saul, to be their king, to whom also he gave their testimony, saying, I have found David, the son of Jesse, a man after my own heart, which shall fulfill all my will. Now hold it right there. When I hear people quote this text, they quote it out of context sometimes. Well, David killed Uriah the Hittite and they had sex with Bathsheba out of wedlock. Therefore, God said he was a man after my own heart. See? Look at that. Therefore, which means that I can go and sin too. That's how I hear it prescribed. They don't say we can go and sin too, but they always use this text to say David is a man after God's own heart. Man, look what he did, is what's normally said. And I said, but that's not what God's saying. God's saying David was rebuked by Nathan, felt the sting of the rebuke, recognized that he sinned. Didn't mean he didn't recognize before. He was trying to cover it up. But when he was rebuked, he turned to God and said, Lord, forgive me. And he expected himself to die. If you read the text correctly, Nathan turns and tells him he will not die, but the sword will not depart from his house fourfold. And he lost four of his children in a very dramatic way. So we recognize David's repentance is deep. It doesn't mean we must go and do what David did to experience that kind of repentance. And I'm asking us today, it says, of this man, going back to verse 23, and of this man's seed hath God, according to his promise, raised unto Israel a savior, Jesus. So we're looking at the seed again, the seed of the woman in Revelation 12, the seed of the woman in Genesis chapter 3, the seed of the woman, that savior, Jesus Christ, is the one that we have to repent, be baptized, and we shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. And verse 24 says this: when John had first preached before his coming the baptism of repentance to all the people of Israel, Acts 13, 22-24. Now, the one thing that I recognize, the first words that Jesus spake after he came out of the wilderness, being tempted for 40 days and 40 nights, was repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. He's loving, he's a savior. He is the one who wants to clean us up and make us one with him. But the one thing he wants us to do is to have that born again experience. That seed, Christ had to do something, and so do we. And I'm looking at the time, so I'm going to finish it here. The seed had to die to bring forth life. Jesus had to die to bring forth life. When this seed dies, what does it do in Genesis? It brings forth fruit after its own kind. So as we take on Jesus, he dies and he resurrects, but the fruit that he brings forth and the seed that he brings forth is after its own kind. Genesis tells us this so many times: the tree shall bear fruit after its kind. The animals bring forth offspring after its kind. And so when Jesus dies on the cross and he rose up and we claim his name and we claim to be Christians, we are the seed of Abraham, but also the seed and the brother of Jesus. And we bring forth fruit after his kind. We become the seed that brings forth fruit unto righteousness. So, brethren, I beg us, I implore us as we go through the next few days, that we ponder the things that we put in our hearts and minds. These are seeds. And at the time of judgment, the fruit of these seeds will be seen. I'm praying that we can come before God and Christ and ask him to cleanse us from all sin and renew us a right spirit and a clean heart, so that the seeds that we place in ourselves does not come from the stone, the rock of Satan, but it comes from the table of showbread. It's the manna that comes from heaven, not from the north, not from the sides of the north, because he wants to give us his bread. Brethren, let's take the bread of Christ rather than the bread of Satan. And by God's grace, we will speak tomorrow. By God's grace. Thank you.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Brother Don. You know, who is like our God that will save his people from the enemy of sin? No one. But we have to ask the Lord for help so that we can die of self. The self is the hardest thing to get rid of, self. But thank you, Brother Don, for another powerful reminder that the deceiver is real. He is real. And we just want to ask the Lord to cleanse us from all the unrighteousness. As you said, the seed, when it's planted, it will germinate. So I pray that we were all blessed today with the presentation. And thank you once again, Brother Don, and bless you and your family.
Thank you, my sister.
So now we'll have a song from the Tutley Twins. Thank you.
The song I'm going to share is called Born Again. Jesus answered and said unto him, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. John chapter 3, verse 3. Tell me how the wind blows. Tell me where the wind goes. You hear it singing through the sky. You can't see what you feel, but you know that it's real, like the spirit in your heart that softly sighs. Born again, you can be born again. You can live in the Father's love.
Amen. Born again. Amen. Thank you. Thank you, sisters. Sister Judith, can you give us a closing prayer, please?
Yes.
Let her pray. Yeah, okay. Let her pray. Our Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for the message which has come to us this evening. We thank you for our brother John, who presented to us that your word is the bread of life and how the enemy was tempting Jesus, the one who gave us the bread of life, to take his bread, oh Father, And we are being tempted as well here. But Lord, we ask that you give us victory. And I pray that you help us to have that victory, Lord, so that we overcome. Father, we know that we cannot do it on our own. We know we are so weak on our own. But we thank you because you promised to help us to do this in us, Lord. You say to abide in me and our help us and teach us to abide in you. Help us to surrender all. And Lord, forgive us where we have been failing you. Cleanse our hearts and make us whole. As we separate going, you know, to then I pray that you be with each and every one of us on this platform. I pray for the families represented on this platform, Lord. Bless each and every family and keep us faithful until we meet again tomorrow. Lord, keep us safe throughout the night and continue to speak to our hearts. May your Holy Spirit continue to fill us so that we are not thrown away from you. Thank you, Father, for hearing our prayer. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Sister Judith, for that beautiful prayer. Thank you.
Amen.
And thank you, everyone, for joining. And now we'll give the announcement. At 4:45, we'll have morning prayers. 5:30, we have the Desire of Ages. At 12, we have midday prayer. At 6:30, song service. And at 7 p.m., we have another message from Brother Don. So please join us again. And thank you once again, everyone, and have a blessed night. Good night.
Thank you, everyone, for coming, and have a good night as well. Take care. God bless.
Good night.
Good night, everyone.
Good night, everyone. Good night.
Good night.